Welcome to part 4 of the Skeletal Animation tutorial mini-series. Today we're going to integrate the two matrices that we got introduced to in the previous video, the offset and the transformation, into our skinned mesh class. This includes two steps. First, we need to transform the vertex from local space to bone space using the offset matrix. Next, we need to multiply the bone space position by the transformation matrix of the node and continue multiplying while traversing all the way to the top of the hierarchy. This will bring us back to local space. So we started in local space and we ended up in local space, so what has changed? Well, basically nothing. In this tutorial, we are still not applying the animation data, which is what actually animates the model. We are just applying the base transformations calculated somewhere between Blender and Assimp, so the expectation is that we will get the model back in pause mode. Now, remember that in addition to the matrices, we're going to use the weights to perform a weighted average of the transformations, so this result is far from negligible. It's an important milestone on the way to our final destination. Okay, so let's review the changes in the skinned mesh class, and we begin with skinnedmesh.h. I've added a public function called getBoneTransforms. This function will be called in the render loop. It basically calculates all the transformations for all the bones and returns them in a vector of matrices, which the caller must supply as a reference. Each bone has a single matrix which we can access in the vector using its bone ID. In the final implementation, this function also takes the current time as a parameter, and then it returns a different set of matrices in each call based on the current posture of the model. In this tutorial, we still don't need it, so I dropped it for now. In the private section, I've added a function called readNodeHierarchy. I'll talk more about this function when we get to the implementation of this class. I've also added the SMP importer object and the pointer to the AI scene object as private attributes, and the reason is that we will need to access the hierarchy in the scene during runtime. When I tried to do it in the previous implementation, where the importer was a local variable in the function loadMesh, I got a segmentation fault, so I guess that we need to keep the importer alive throughout the execution. And finally, we have a structure called boneInfo, which stores a couple of matrices. We have the bone offset matrix, which is here for easy access. Final transformation stores the intermediate results of the whole transformation chain so that when the entire process is complete, we just grab it from here and return it to the application. The constructor of this class takes the offset matrix as a parameter, it stores it in the corresponding member, and it initializes the transformation matrix to zero. And of course, we also have a vector of bone info structures, one structure for each bone. Okay, so this concludes the changes in the header. As always, you can compare this file to the previous version, actually in part 2, because in part 3, we only touched the sandbox, and you'll be able to see all of these changes. Now let's take a look at the CPP file. We have a minor change in the loadMesh function. Instead of the local variables for the importer and the scene, we have the new private attributes in the class, so we will use them. The next change is in the loadSingleBone function. After we get the bone ID, we check whether it equals to the size of the bone info vector. If this turns out to be true, we know that this is a new bone because the bone IDs are a running index. In that case, we create a bone info object using the M offset matrix from the AI bone class. Remember that in addition to the weights, the SIMP AI bone class also has this offset matrix. After we initialize the boneInfo object, we push it into the vector. This means that we can access the bone information using the bone index. At the bottom of this file, we have the two new functions. First, we have getBoneTransforms, which takes a reference to a vector of matrices. We start by resizing this vector using the number of bone info structures that we have. Next, we initialize a local matrix to be the identity matrix, and we call readNodeHierarchy using the root node of the scene and this matrix. After readNodeHierarchy returns, we should have the transformations that we need in the final transformation member of the bone info vector, so all we need to do is to copy these matrices to the vectors supplied by the caller. Now let's take a look at the readNodeHierarchy function, which is a bit tricky because it is a recursive function. It takes a pointer to an AI node object and a reference to a parent matrix. The first call to this function is done using the root node of the hierarchy and the identity matrix. We start by creating a node transformation matrix using the M transformation matrix from the node. Next, we create a global transformation matrix by multiplying the parent matrix with this matrix. So we are actually traversing the graph from top to bottom rather than from the node back to the root, because this global matrix is going to be used in the calculation of all of its children. So by going from top to bottom, we can calculate it only once. Note that we're taking advantage of the associativity nature of matrix multiplication that tells us that as long as we keep the order of the matrices, we can change the location of the parentheses. Next, we check if we have a bone that matches the name of the node. All the bones have a corresponding node in the hierarchy, but there may be nodes without bones. We already have a map between bone names and their indices, so this is very easy to do. If we find such a bone, we update its final transformation to be the result of multiplying its offset matrix by the global matrix, which basically captures the entire chain from the node back to the root. Finally, we traverse the children of the current node, and we call readNodeHierarchy recursively on each child node with the global transformation matrix in the second parameter. So as we go deeper into the graph, this global transformation encapsulates more and more M transformation matrices. Let's take a look at the changes in the application code, and this is very simple. In the render function, we define a vector of matrices. We get the bone transformations from the mesh, and we loop over the vector that we got back. We set the matrices into the skinning technique one by one. This is a very simple function that updates a uniform array in the shader, so I'll skip it and you can take a look at it later. The last change is in the vertex shader. We have a new uniform called GBones. This is an array of 100 matrices, so make sure this is enough for the models that you plan to load. In the main function, we create a bone transform matrix as a weighted average of the matrices of all the bones that influence the current vertex. We use the bone IDs of the vertex to access the bone uniform array. Take a look at part 2 if you don't remember where the bone IDs came from. Each bone matrix is multiplied by the corresponding weight, which is also a vertex attribute. If the number of bones is less than 4, the weights will be 0, so the calculation will have no effect. We sum up the results of all these multiplications to get the final bone transformation, and we use it to transform the vertex from local space back into local space. Again, once we integrate the animation data, the position will be different than the original. The shader continues as usual by multiplying the updated local position by the WVP matrix. There is actually no change in the fragment shader, so this concludes this video. The next step is to integrate the animation data so we can finally see something moving. All this and more will be covered in the next tutorial. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button and subscribe. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next tutorial on skeletal animation.